You're listening to the Pace Radio Network here at paceradio.net.
The views expressed by the individuals during this broadcast are their own opinions, and they may not be the same as those of their group or other organizations they may be involved with.
Man, what's the matter with that cat there?
What, he's full of reefers.
Full of reefers?
Yeah, man.
You mean that cat's high?
Sailing.
Sailing
light.
We now wander off the beaten path with an update from the Reefer Reporter.
Good morning and welcome to the Reefer Reporters with News Hawks, Reverend Kelly and myself, Al Graham. We are live here at the Legacy420.com news desk, and we are live on Facebook, YouTube, and we will be podcasted at paceradio.net. Good morning, Reverend Kelly. How are we today?
Good morning. We're everywhere. I love that we're everywhere.
We're everywhere.
It's Facebook, and you can watch us. You can listen to us later. That's wonderful. Thanks for listening, everyone.
And that's right. Normally, Kelly, we discuss the weather, but I have another topic I'd like to bring up, and that is caterpillars.
Okay, I'm ready.
You're ready. How is the gypsy moth caterpillar situation in your neck of the woods?
I have absolutely no idea, but I'd like to learn. Is it called a gypsy moth caterpillar?
Well, yeah, they're caterpillars that turn into gypsy moths. Ooh. And they're an invasive species. Ooh. And they are literally just crawling all over my house. I have two red maples that are devastated because they eat the leaves off the trees.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Oak tree between me and my neighbor, same thing. Almost completely dead because of the leaves. I have neighbors in behind me. Trees have been completely stripped of all the leaves. Yes. Yeah.
Oh no, those naughty little gypsy creatures.
Yeah, and they don't bite, but there's something to do with their hair or something, and they're leaving like mosquito bite marks, but with a red rash, and people's arms and their backs and everything are breaking out.
This sounds like a horror movie.
Oh, it does, doesn't it? Yeah.
What?
And people are describing the itch like shingles and the whole bit.
And this is happening in your backyard currently right now.
Yeah, my front yard right now. There is so much caterpillar shit in my driveway that when it rained the other day, the cat tiptoed across the driveway because it was going, ew, yeah.
What can you do to get rid of these awful creatures?
There's a spray you can put onto the trees and they will eat the leaves, right? That's what they do. They eat the leaves and this spray will kill them as they digest the leaves.
Okay.
The problem is that when you spray this stuff on with a hand sprayer or pump and all that, you can only reach so far, so much height. I've got trees that are over 50 feet high.
Oh, my goodness.
You can't get to the top of these things. Now, this all happened, I believe, back in the 80s as well, and the provincial government actually sprayed the province.
Oh, my goodness. Well, I think it sounds like that's going to have to happen again. What if these guys get into the cannabis plants?
Oh, I don't know if they like cannabis plants or not, but I know that they love red maples, oaks, and all other kinds. Like, they drop down out of the trees. They're literally hanging in front of you. Walk right into them.
This is just awful.
Feces is all over the sidewalk and out in front of my house on the road. It's just all, road pizza with caterpillars.
This is horrible. It really sounds horrible. I don't mean to laugh, but it doesn't even sound real. It sounds like I've put on a movie.
It's like a
horror movie.
You go to my Facebook wall and you'll see the video of me washing the driveway. Like, our cars are getting covered in it, our vehicles.
Terrible.
We've had to park our vehicles in different spots and everything just because of the crap. Literally, feces all over them.
And they're called gypsy moss caterpillars?
Yeah, the caterpillars. Yeah, yeah.
They sound like evil creatures.
Yes. Rob McNabb says, hi, everybody. And he says, these moths are terrible. He says, that's horrible. And I can, this is brutal, man. Really. Mm-hmm. All righty. Let's get on. Well, actually, anything new at the news at the lounge this past week?
Nothing really going on. We're hoping to open up after the 14th for little visits and people to come by. That would good. Be nice. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, that's right. All right. Let's get on with the news. All right. And our first story of the day comes to us from basically from Marijuana Biz Daily, and that is that medical cannabis reimbursements for Canadian veterans soars past $100 million.
Mm-hmm. It's a wonderful graph in front of us here showing how it's exceeding right in 2021. Medical cannabis reimbursements by Veterans Affairs Canada reached an all-time high last year, offsetting an overall decline in spending among the general population.
That's right. Back in 2021 fiscal year ended in March the 31st, and Veterans Affairs Canada reimbursed 15,369 clients, a total of $119 million for medical cannabis products, according to the latest figures from the department responsible for benefits and services of retired and serving armed forces members. Just so you know, Kelly, the last figure I knew of was there was 10,000.
That's 10,000.
And that's gone up 50% in the last, wow. I'm going to say probably in the last 2 years.
Oh my goodness.
And you know that our local Legion does not allow cannabis on its property.
Does not allow it?
Yeah.
Oh, that's
too bad. They have a sign. They have signs on the building.
No cannabis.
No cannabis.
That's too bad. Well, it shows with this increase here how many veterans actually need it. It's saying that it's increased over the previous year when 13,270 clients were reimbursed, $85.1 million. So it shows an increase. It's good to see that the government is reimbursing. Not good to see that there's so many veterans that need it.
Yes, exactly. They say to put that in global perspective, Veterans Canada or Veteran Affairs Canada fiscal year spending on medical cannabis exceeded Australia's medical cannabis market in 2020, which was estimated to be worth approximately $100 million.
Okay, well, the 14,463 kilograms of cannabis reimbursed by the Veterans Affairs Canada in 2020 was ahead of the European Union's legal flower market that year, which dispensed approximately 10,000 kilograms.
Yeah, that points to how small some of the largest medical cannabis markets outside of North America remain and how much room there is to grow. And the medical cannabis uptake by Canadian veterans comes as overall spending in Canada on the medicine has largely stagnated in recent years. So, saying that basically, patients aren't consuming as much, but yet veterans is going up.
Yes.
Well, more veterans are seeing the benefits.
Absolutely, they are. Absolutely, they are. Now, the veterans account for about a quarter of Canada's medical cannabis market by spending. In 2019, household spending on cannabis products for medical use was $618 million, falling slightly in 2020 to $587 million.
Yeah. They say most licensed producers devoted more of their resources to meeting demand in the recreational market after Canada ended adult use cannabis prohibition, and I have to agree with that. Mm-hmm. Two LPs that didn't look that way were Aurora and Canopy, they say.
Mm-hmm. Well, the Edmonton, Alberta-based Aurora has struggled to gain a foothold in the cutthroat recreational market. Its medical business is faring far better than ever.
Yeah, that's right. Aurora CEO Michael Martin says veterans are a critical part of the medical business. He says veterans serve a special role for us out of respect for their service, so we do things differently for them. In many cases, we are providing a concierge service to them, he says in an interview. As an example, Martin said Aurora has a standalone queue for veterans who phone in the company's call center. And he says that they're critical to them. So that's what Aurora says.
Yeah. I'm glad to hear that. I hope that continues. Spectrum Therapies, Canopy Growth's medical cannabis subsidiary, also has dedicated channels to serve its Canadian veterans. They're quoted as saying, whether through dedicated and specialized customer support for veterans, full coverage is the best in-class stores and Bickel vaporizer or pre-approval and direct billing. Spectrum's veteran care program simplifies medical cannabis and ensures that Canadian veterans have the reliable and barrier-free access that they need. That's according to Amanda Daly from Spectrum Therapies. So at least they're taking that into serious consideration here.
Yeah. Yeah.
I like that.
Dedicated customer service for veterans. Full coverage for vaporizers, including the Stoltz and Bickel, which would be the volcano vaporizers, because Canopy owns Stolz and Bickel now, so they own the the volcano vaporizer.
Yep.
As well as a 20% discount for anyone using medical cannabis while serving.
That's amazing. The fact that they can just get a $300 credit for one of those machines, I love that. Yeah. I really do. I think that's very important. These people have served for our country.
That's right. Exactly. That's right. The military's growing spending on medical cannabis reflects more private and public sector organizations covering such expenses in their corporate benefit plans. Uniform, Canada's largest private sector union, partnered with the licensed producer Leafly Health late last year to provide medical cannabis coverage to its members, for instance.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So it's good to see this. There are coverage there for some people, but we need more coverage.
We certainly do need more, but maybe recognizing how much is needed will push that further. Maybe the other companies will get on board.
Yes. Yeah.
The big ones. Yeah. It's good. Yeah,
exactly. Exactly. So it's good to see. You know, more veterans are getting involved in the cannabis end. And I know that several years ago, the veterans were getting 10 grams a day, and it was the government didn't like the cost, so they dropped them down to 3 grams a day. And now the costs are going high again. So what's going to happen now?
Oh, they better not drop them down again. Yeah, the big guys need to get involved. They need to have programs like the Spectrum one. Canopy should be getting in there, unless they, of course, have a big giant loss to account for.
Well, I'm sure we'll get to that at some point. Like right now, in the MJ Biz Daily, they report that the cannabis producer Canopy Growth posts a $1.7 billion annual loss.
Oh, Jesus, that's their fourth quarter, and it's alongside an annual loss, the $617 million Canadian dollars for the fourth quarter, and that's $1.7 billion for the 2021 fiscal year. I just can't even believe that.
They said
that despite their growing revenue, what if they're having growing revenue? How are they saying they've lost $1.7 billion? That's $1.7 billion.
Wow, that means the losses would have been worse.
What?
Yep. Adjusted earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, amortization, and non-standard measure of profitability was negative $94 million for the quarter and a negative $340 million for the year.
Now, Now, the Smith Falls company, Ontario, they were on track for the positive adjusted during the second half of their current fiscal year that ends March 31st, 2022. But on a Tuesday conference with their analysts, their CEO, David Klein, said in light of the significant recent acquisitions by Canadian competitors, the company was very happy with our portfolio in Canada and with the ability of the portfolio to travel to the U.S.
Yeah, just waiting to head south.
What?
Just heading to head south. That's right. Okay. Just waiting for the big word from Joe there. That's all. One of these deals is Hikos. Is planned a $925 million acquisition of Redecan, one of the leading adult use producers in the country, according to shares. And in April, Canopy announced a deal to acquire premium Canadian producer Supreme, as well as a deal to acquire cannabis brand Ace Valley.
Right.
Bye.
I love some of these LPs. I love some of these products. Canopy's just eating them up. But how are they eating them up if they just recorded $1.7 billion loss?
I have no clue.
I do not understand.
Well, according to David Klein, he added that if you look at where we would focus next with our balance sheet and with an eye toward mergers and acquisitions, it's going to be the U.S. Okay. And just so you know, Canopy reported cash and short-term investments worth $2.3 billion.
Wow. He says he was really bullish regarding the potential speed of federal legalization efforts in the U.S., saying, "I believe we're in a position now where you have Republicans and Democrats who are each trying to craft their own cannabis bills. What they're not questioning is, should cannabis be legalized? They're simply questioning the how." So I guess he's saying, waiting, like rubbing our hands together, waiting until they make it happen.
Yeah, and if it's coming from both parties, I know it's more so from the Democratic Party than from the Republican Party, but there are some Republicans on board.
Right.
Then, yeah, you know, that question comes to, like he says, it comes down to how.
Yeah.
You know, how is it going to be done? So, okay. Yeah. Canopy said it's captured 19% of the total flower category in Canada's recreational market during the fourth quarter, and based on internal merits, along with 11% of the coveted, I'll get that word out, premium cannabis market. So they say that they got 11% of the, you know, big brands,
right,
that are out, that people are enjoying.
Yeah, who knows how they're going to do. Obviously, they're thinking that they're buying everybody up. Now, their revenue in the past quarter that ended March 31st, their dry bud was almost $68 million for the dry bud, and then almost $7 million for oils and soft gels. Their beverages are still doing well. Beverages, edibles, topicals, and vapes at $7 million.
Yeah,
that's not bad at all for that.
No. Yeah, I'm just wondering, is that Canadian numbers or is that Canopy's numbers? Either way, is it still, you know, good number? it's more than we would have got 2 years ago. So
certainly.
All righty, there we go. That's another story covered, and on to our next one. And this is going to take us out west, and at one time, Alberta was leading us in the number of stores in the country.
Yeah.
And now, according to this report in the Calgary Herald, Albertans leads the national efforts to unshackle Canada's cannabis industry.
Absolutely. It talks about an Alberta man named Nathan Meeson. He says that there's no accident that he's co-chairing a bid to empower the country's cannabis sector. He says it's a crucial review of Canada's legalization of the drug that he's near.
Yep, the province's outsized presence in the country's cannabis retail industry makes it likely that someone like him would lead the Canadian Chamber of Commerce's efforts to supercharge the sector with a fairly mandated review to begin 3 years after legalization. So he must be a member of the Canadian Chamber of Commerce, maybe.
Maybe. Now he's a former executive with Fire and Flower, and he says Alberta has four of the largest cannabis retailers in the world based here. Pointed out that on June 2nd, Calgary headquartered High Tide became the first Canadian cannabis retailer to be listed on the NASDAQ exchange.
Yeah, he says that it's because Alberta's leadership with these companies have been able to scale and grow. He's a past chair of the Alberta Cannabis Council.
Okay. Alberta has by far the largest number of cannabis stores per capita in Canada. I think right now they do, Al, but isn't Ontario set to have the largest by September?
They say per capita, so that's per person. Versus the number of stores overall per province.
I think they're sitting on it still, but we keep getting new ones every day.
Yeah, like as far as store numbers, yeah, we have either we're right with them or surpass them,
yeah.
But we have more people in our province than Alberta, so they have, you know, less people per store.
Yeah. Now they say that the critical mass of expertise and its counterparts in other provinces are needed to weigh in on a review of the Federal Cannabis Act, which itself triggers a review of how legalization has worked and what can improve in 3 years, if in 3 years, according to Meeson.
Yeah, and he says that this should include a dramatic liberalization of highly restricted marketing and consumption rules governing the industry. The feds haven't done anything on cannabis lounges. Why can't we have a conversation where we have cannabis infused in foods and cannabis cocktails to be served there? Exactly. What do you think, Kelly?
Please, that would save our businesses. Now, what Canada dithers on consumption cafes, border states, including Michigan and New York, are moving ahead on them.
Yes, they are. They sure are. he says here that the industry is also seeking to lift the 10 milligram cap on THC for individual edible sales and constraints on packaging, both governed by federal law and also areas in which the U.S. states have more liberalized approach. That 10 milligram cap has got to go.
Yeah. At very least for medical patients, at least let medical patients buy it. If you want to keep that for rec for a little while, fine, but at least allow these medical patients to buy more than that. Tight limits on the in-store promotion of brands is another sore spot that should be included in the review, according to Meeson and John Carl, who is the executive director of the Alberta Cannabis Council.
Now, let's get something straight. You don't want to have advertising in promotions inside the store because the adult that's going to buy the product is going to see the promotion. But don't forget, minors aren't allowed in the store. Nope. So it's not the fact that the kids are going to see these things.
Yep. Absolutely. No advertising. I know.
Yeah, exactly. I got no problem with that. They also go on to say, just as you can sample wine or beer in the liquor store, you should be able to have a hoot of a joint or consume a tiny amount of edible just to get the flavor.
I'm up for that. I would never leave the stores.
Yeah.
I turn again.
Yeah, I was expecting more of consume a bit of the edible, drink a little taste, have a little taste of the drink.
Yeah.
I wasn't expecting to read off the hoot of a joint, but hey, I'm all for that too, you know.
Why not? If you could do that in the beer store, the LCBO, right?
Yes.
I'm loving this idea.
Yeah. He says you can have a big Budweiser display, but in our stores, all you can talk about is how much THC there is in a product and how much it costs. It doesn't make for a very healthy industry.
Oh, and he's also suggesting that the 30-gram possession limit for legal cannabis should also be increased. I wonder why. Saying nearly three years for recreational legalization has dispelled critics' worst fears of its societal effects, and the industry should be rewarded for operating responsibly.
That's right. Exactly. And we are seeing spots in the U.S. where it's more than 30 grams.
Yeah.
For three years, we've learned the lessons. Why don't we loosen these rules? It's exactly.
Yeah.
Let's see what else is. He goes on to say that Ottawa should loosen product excise tax or stamp restrictions to prevent interprovincial trade. Yeah.
That's like, true too. Yeah.
Well, there's not much we're disagreeing with on this one.
I don't think there is. No.
No. The biggest barrier holding back the industry development is a mental one with a stigmatized view of cannabis persisting.
Still continuing, yeah. Quoted as saying, our politicians are still caught in the stereotypical tropes of the past. We have to get away from the fear. We can't talk about cannabis.
That's right. The industry now contributes at least $16.5 billion to Canada's annual GDP and should be recognized within an economic framework that allows its expertise to become another of the country's exports.
Yes, it should. That's a lot of money. $16.5 billion. Come on. Let's recognize that. It should include rolling the industry within provincial and federal departments such as agriculture. Oh, that's a good point.
Yeah, exactly. And you see, our primary focus, he says, has been on the health and displacing the black market, but that should expand. And look at the next line.
His National Cannabis Working Group within the Canadian Chamber of Commerce is crafting a presentation for the Health Canada-led review of the Cannabis Act.
He's within a working group within the Chamber of Commerce. Yay. I got two thumbs up going on here.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Hopefully they come up with some good ideas. They get them submitted in there, and their ideas are rewarded and become reality.
I hope they do. He's got some really good ideas.
Yeah. I agree. Okay. Next story.
Back to Canopy.
And I think I remember hearing you talking about this.
Yeah.
At one time, rapper Drake and cannabis company Canopy Growth End Pot Partnership. I think I was hearing you talk about when they joined.
Yeah, I think that we covered that story. It wasn't. Yeah. But now they're saying goodbye to him. Goodbye.
Goodbye. Yep.
It's over. Want to be involved with the rapper. His company is called More Life Growth Company, and they say that they're dissolving it. They're dissolving their partnership.
That's right. Canopy and Drake announced that they would work together back in November 2019 and structured the partnership around an agreement where Drake would hold a 6% stake in this More Life, and Canopy will hold 40%. But according to financial statements filed this week, the company says that both parties agreed to terminate their sub-license agreement at the start of March, and Canopy recognized a $10.3 million impairment on investment later that month. So that means they gave him $10 million.
I'm not sure.
Or did they just lose $10 million?
I feel like they just lost $10 million. That's what it sounds like. Maybe their impairment, but yeah. Maybe they had to give it to them. I certainly hope not. Now the statements also show that Canopy derecognized almost $33 million in remaining minimum royalty obligations owing to More Life. Is it their, like, are they saying goodbye, or is he saying goodbye to them? Is what I can't understand.
Well, nobody's saying, because it says here, Campy did not share why it dissolved things, and Drake's publicist and agency representing him did not immediately respond.
Okay, so I think if they're the ones that pursued the divestiture,
yeah,
then it's them saying goodbye to him. And you know, maybe because he's not been very successful, and maybe this business hasn't been very successful, I'm not sure why they wanted to link with him anyway. I think it actually was more of a black mark on their business than anything.
Oh, yeah.
He's not publicly presented as a very kind man.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All I know is that he's connected to Toronto somehow, and the Raptors or something, isn't he?
Something like that. And he's a rap star, but I think he's been, toted with a lot of negativity.
Yeah.
So maybe they're just saying, oh, well, we don't need that kind of publicity. I think they're better to take a leave from that then.
All righty. Okay, on to talking about taking a leave and saying goodbye. This next story comes to us from StratCan. Headline says Manitoba cancels retail license with First Nation over operation of unlicensed retail store.
Yep, they've terminated their retail agreement with NAC Long Plain Limited Partnership, and their retail license has been canceled with the Liquor, Gaming, and Cannabis Authority of Manitoba. This is of this past Thursday.
Yeah, the store, a partnership with Meta Cannabis Supply Company, was suspended by the province on May 19th because the Long Plain First Nation, which is a majority owner of NAC Long Plain Limited Partnership, also operates a retail store not licensed by the provincial government.
Okay, so the statement from the LGCA says the provincial regulator has taken steps over the last month to work with the First Nation to operate within Manitoba's legal cannabis framework.
Yeah, I wonder if they just told them that they had to shut down the store on the reserve.
Maybe.
And that was the end of the negotiation. Long Plains First Nations failure to respond to efforts to cooperate with both organizations and the continued ongoing sale of unregulated cannabis from an unlicensed store on the First Nations Kishkaqua Reserve prompted the agreement termination and license cancellation today. Selling cannabis that has been manufactured at a facility without a federal production license poses serious risks to consumer safety, according to the LGCA.
So these guys are like maybe the AGCO here?
Correct.
So here's my question. Isn't the band councils responsible for sovereign indigenous cannabis?
Yeah,
I'm not sure. Maybe in this province, these guys get involved? Because in our province, the AGCO cannot get involved with that.
Yeah, so what I'm seeing here is because, for example, if our reserves, we have lots of reserves with stores on them, and we have a couple of places that have some legal, like provincial licenses, operated stores. Now, if those provincially operated stores went and opened up a store on this reserve that wasn't licensed by the AGCO, I could see the AGCO stepping in like these.
Absolutely.
Guys.
Okay, yeah. That makes sense. Yes.
It says here that Manitoba owes it to its licensed and regulated cannabis retailers and producers who've made a significant investment in Canada's burgeoning legal cannabis industry to deliver safe and regulated products to Manitoba, according to the president of the Manitoba Liquor and Lotteries.
Okay, so a representative from the Long Plain First Nation was unavailable for comment. The unlicensed retail store in question is an Indigenous Bloom, a chair of First Nations affiliated retailers based primarily in British Columbia. A representative from Indigenous Bloom was also unavailable as of press time.
Omar Khan, senior vice president, corporate and public affairs of High Tide Inc., that owns Meta Cannabis, clarifies that they are not connected to the unlicensed retail store and are selling their remaining interest in the formerly licensed store at 420 Madison Street to the Long Plains First Nation, effectively ending their partnership.
Okay, well, they're quoted as saying, earlier today we were informed that our license in Madsen, Manitoba, which is associated with a limited partnership with Long Plains First Nation, has been terminated due to allegations of regulatory non-compliance of an unrelated business interest of the majority partner. Does it sound like maybe they went from legacy to legal and now they're just kind of cutting their ties so that they can be legal?
Yeah, so it looks like that way.
Maybe
yeah.
That's what they're doing. And then maybe they should be patient with them while they do that.
Maybe. It says here that they have no relationship with these outside business interests. And all of our stores, including the Madison location, operate in full compliance with all the cannabis laws and regulations.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, hopefully they're going to get this straightened out, because it sounds like people are going to be missing out on their medicine while they're doing it.
Yeah. It says that many First Nations communities in Canada have argued since before legalization that they have a right to manage cannabis businesses in their communities without oversight from provincial or federal regulations. Cannabis producer in Ontario recently began selling to retailers in First Nation communities, including Indigenous Bloom.
I think they need that. I think they have the right to that. I think that if they're, you know, the band council is governing this cannabis, sovereign gun cut cannabis, the money goes back to those communities, the money stays in the communities, it doesn't go to the government, the provincial government. I think they should be doing it this way. Yeah.
Now, as it says there, you know, they've been, what is it, about the one First Nations cannabis producer in Ontario has began selling to retailers in First Nation communities. I know Legacy 420 does that. They sell to other communities. Yeah. Maybe that's who they're talking about.
Oh, it might be, actually.
Might be. Yeah.
Isn't that neat?
Yes, that's right.
It all ties together, but it's a beautiful thing. These guys are working hard and they're making a difference. They're doing things the right way.
That's right. Exactly. I completely agree with you. All right. We got some comments here. Tamara Cartwright, she says, wow. I'm not sure what it was about.
Okay.
And Ron McNabb says they need to realize that they're literally playing with people's lives. And Tamara goes on to say lies. So, yeah, there you go. Some comments about what we're reporting on. Okay. And it's medication time. Reverend Kelly and I will be right back after a joint session. You are watching the Reefer Reporters live here on Facebook, YouTube, or hearing the audio podcast afterwards at paceradio.net.
You're listening to the Pace Radio Network here at paceradio.net.
Growing your own vegetables, flowers, or even medicinal plants can be a challenge without the right equipment and proper know-how. At BMA Hydroponics, not only are they your urban horticultural experts and suppliers, but their staff holds the customer's needs paramount to making a sale. Family-owned with decades of experience and knowledge, they offer free advice in person, by phone, or email. BMA Hydroponics wants to ensure you have the advice you need, which is why you'll find tips and tricks on different ways to grow, like wick, ebb and flow, drip, or aeroponic system, as well as other helpful links at bmahydroponics.com. If you can't find what you're looking for, just let them know, and they'll do everything they can to get what you're looking for. At BMA Hydroponics, each staff member also possesses a federal exemptee MMAR license, making their strong suit empathy, experience, and dedication to their customers. Because when you know how to grow, you'll have results that make you proud. BMA Hydroponics in Belleville, Ontario. Visit bmahydroponics.com.
CT, CP operates a medicinal cannabis signing clinic. If you want to grow your own medicinal cannabis and are located anywhere in Canada, then I'd like to suggest that you give them a call. They can be reached at 1-613-967-9888. That's 1-613-967-9888. And grow on with CTCP.
Pace Radio is the People Advocating Cannabis Education Radio Network.
A doctor's job is to relieve your pains. And when it comes to growing cannabis, the biggest pain is trimming. Let Dr. Buck Cannabis Trimming Solutions take the pain away. Whether you're a home grower or a commercial operation, we have the cure. From 4 plants to 400 plants, garden size doesn't matter. Dr. Buck Cannabis Trimming Solutions comes to you with years of experience and professional discreet service. It's simple. We trim your weed and we do a damn good job. Visit drbuckcts.com to book your trimming.
Enjoy the buzz of legalization with Campbellford Lifestyle Shop. From lights to plant nutrients, books, consumption accessories, and more, we've got all your basics to grow or consume cannabis. Visit our info center or take a look at our piercing services and body jewelry, now available in-store through Campbellford Lifestyle Shop, 17 Bridge Street West, Campbellford.
At Legacy 420, we believe in being different.
Experience the difference of quality control.
Our labs provide tested formulations for all of our products.
Experience the difference in trust.
Our customers can trust that we are following up-to-date COVID precautions for their safety.
Experience the difference in accessibility.
We're open 7 days a week. Please visit our website, legacy420.com, or contact us for curbside pickup as well as nationwide mail order shipping.
Legacy 420 values overall wellness.
Come and experience the difference of Legacy 420.
You're listening to the Pace Radio Network here at paceradio.net.
Hey, we're back from a medication session, and we are live here on Facebook, YouTube, and being podcasted at paceradio.net. Well, Reverend Kelly, we got the first five stories completed. You ready to do five more?
Five more. I'm ready.
Five more. All right. Here we go into the next session, and we're going to head to Millbrook, Nova Scotia. According to Global News, five are facing charges after the RCMP raid cannabis dispensaries in Millbrook.
And we both live near a little village called Millbrook, not too far from where we live. So when I first read this, I thought, Millbrook? What? Just up the road. But it's not. It's Nova Scotia. They were three cannabis dispensaries that were raided this past Wednesday.
That's right. Exactly. In a press release, Nova Scotia RCMP said large quantity of cannabis, cash, and cannabis products were seized. Cannabis products, and cash.
That's right.
Nice to read something that doesn't include all those other stuff.
Yeah. Just cannabis. And it was First Nations dispensaries. Oh. Yes, they've been giving warnings to cease their operations, the police said, and the other dispensaries could also face charges if they don't comply with the warning. So it sounds like they were operating illegally, and they've been warned, and now they've been shut down.
Yeah, they said that the raids came as a result of increased community complaints. The court is saying we get increased complaints in that area concerning the products being sold and the public nearby that frequents by young people which promoted the police action at their storefronts. So our goal is to have these unlicensed storefronts cease operation.
It sounds like when they have the dispensaries at the reserves near us, they operate okay because they're protected by these band councils that we're referring to, and they're protected by their own governments. But it sounds like maybe these guys weren't. They were operating not under that fashion.
Because it was First Nations.
Yeah, and if the police can raid them, then that means that they're not protected.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, that's not good. I would think that what happens here in Ontario and other provinces when it comes to the Indigenous laws, when it comes to cannabis, that it would be the same in Nova Scotia.
Yeah. Yeah, you would hope it would be. So it's interesting. And you know, hearing our last article about this is, you know, this, I think something needs to be done a little bit more with this sovereign cannabis. They're not acting under the AGCO or the Manitoba Act. Yeah, need to be taken care of.
That's right. Yep. Well, they got their own, get their own cannabis act. And
they should.
Yeah. And I would say that most of us would be upset because theirs would be better.
Certainly would be. Well, it's their stores, and I'm talking about close by. We can go in there and we can get all kinds of information, medical yeah. help and help dosing. And, you know, their bud mm-hmm. tenders are trained differently. They're there to help with medical information, whereas the adult use stores, the legal stores, we can't get that kind of stuff there.
Yeah, yeah, exactly, exactly. Yeah. All right, on to our next story in the Marijuana Moment. Headline says that testing people for cannabis impairment based on THC levels is, in quotes, not reliable. Fairly funded study finds.
Duh. Duh. The amount of THC in a person's system after consuming cannabis is not accurate. It's not an accurate predictor of impairment. This is according to a federally funded study.
Yep. The research, backed by a grant from the National Institute of Justice, involved 20 people who either ate or vaporized cannabis with varying levels of THC. They were then tested with basic field sobriety and cognitive tests.
Now, while the groups that received doses higher than 5 milligrams of THC were all negatively impacted and experienced observable, I guess that psychomotor impairment, the RTI International researchers found that the THC levels in biofluids were not a reliable indicator of cannabis intoxication for their study participants.
That's right. That raises questions about per se laws that are in place in several states barring people from driving if they have more than a certain amount of THC in their blood. Mm.
My goodness. What would you be impaired if you ate 5 milligrams of THC, Al?
No.
I don't even think I would flinch a little bit with that.
I don't even think I could test as low as 5 milligrams before I even ate that edible.
I know. So it does vary. It doesn't include us when it talks about it.
Right.
It's so silly. Normal Deputy Director Paul Armentano said these important findings come as no surprise. Of course they don't.
He goes on to say, despite a handful of states imposing per se THC thresholds, let's include Canada in that, as part of their traffic safety laws, there exists no science demonstrating that these arbitrary limits are reliable predictors of either recent cannabis exposure or impairment.
Now, the study, which was published last year and promoted by NIJ in a tweet on Thursday, also found that various tests, including standing on one leg, balancing and walking and turning, were, quoting, not sensitive to cannabis intoxication for any of the study participants. I know.
Throughout the test, participants' blood, urine, and oral fluid were collected and then sent to forensic laboratories. Results from the toxicology test showed that the levels of all three targeted cannabis components, THC, cannabidiol, and cannabinol, in blood, urine, and oral fluid did not corroborate with cognitive and psychomotive impairment measures for oral or vaporized cannabis administration.
Wow. Wow. I will tell you, I recently did a dab. It was quite a large dab. And I afterwards walked on my tippy toes and did all kinds of acrobatic activities to show that I had done that and that how it affected me. It's a complete individual thing. It depends on your individual endocannabinoid system. This yeah. is a beautiful study showing this. This is a beautiful study explaining that.
Now, the agency goes on to say that many other study participants had significantly decreased cognitive and psychoactive functioning, even when their blood, urine, and oral fluid contained low levels of THC. The researchers also observed that standardized field sobriety tests, commonly used to detect driving under the influence of drugs or alcohol, were not effective in detecting cannabis intoxication.
What a great, I love that. What a great quote. And then it goes on to say, in other words, THC does not lead to impairment. Absolutely.
Hang on. You inserted a word there. Reword that again.
It does lead to impairment. Oh, it does lead to impairment. In some cases.
Yeah, but the concentration of that compound in the bodily fluids does not accurately corroborate with the extent to which a person is impaired. So you can,
But that's just it. So that 5 milligram edible is going to affect somebody else far differently than it would affect you or I.
Yeah.
And the dabs, whatever it is, whatever way you're consuming it, it's going to affect everyone differently.
They say when it comes to low doses, it seems some people are not negatively impacted, at least with respect to standard tests that researchers utilize. Mm. That's people like you and me and others that are patients that use it all the time.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's so nice that they're recognizing this because it cannot be considered along the same lines of alcohol. It cannot.
No. They say here a congressional research body also released a report in 2019 that found the evidence about cannabis ability impaired driving is currently inconclusive. Researchers have found on several occasions that traffic facilities do not increase after a state legalizes cannabis.
Oh, how lovely. When they're doing these tests, when they're pulling people over, are they testing for the opiates that are impairing people?
Well, the new tests that they use for the cannabis, the saliva test, will detect other drugs as well.
Well, as long as they're not just targeting cannabis.
Well, that's the main target.
Our medicine, which we need to drive.
Yeah, I know a guy. He was on 20 perks a day, and he was operating a business that required him to drive.
My God.
And not only to drive, but also move other people's vehicles.
See? Right there. Yeah. And then I bet you that guy, if he tested for cannabis, he'd be out the door.
Yeah. He's no longer with us now. But it just goes to show that. Yeah. And I know a person who was on methadone and worked as a bus operator.
Oh, my God. See? But get to our plant.
Yeah.
This, right?
Yeah.
Okay. We'll get it all worked out one day, Al. They'll figure it out.
They will. All right. On to our next story. And this one comes to us from MJ Biz Daily. And it says, how playing in the carbon markets can benefit cannabis producers.
I found this really interesting. It's very interesting.
Environmental end of cannabis.
Yeah. So it's saying that carbon is a hot commodity, and it's the biggest buzzword in agriculture in recent months, is the potential for paying farmers to sequester carbon through environmentally responsible land stewardship becomes more likely after the U.S. re-enrolled in an international treaty on climate change. President Joe Biden proposed a carbon market to directly pay farmers.
Yep. The potential for carbon payments has special interest for farmers growing hemp, which reportedly gobbles carbon at a rate of 6 tons per acre, according to the European Industrial Hemp Association, and can play a key role in regenerative farming and soil remediation.
Isn't that amazing? Don't you? It's healing so many things. It's so many things. Now, it's a nature-based solution figure prominently in the treaty's goal to substantially reduce greenhouses gas emissions and limit global warming to 1.5 to 2 degrees Celsius above the pre-industrial levels by 2100. So not during our lifetime, Al, but they're hoping that this is what they're going to do in the next 100 years.
Yeah. They say based on current policy, the Earth is on track for a 3.5 degree Celsius global warming by 2100. Even taking governmental pledges into account, according to the 2020 UN report. As a result, nearly 2,000 companies have made net zero carbon commitments by 2030 or 2050.
Isn't that beautiful? So beautiful. Let's plant it everywhere. It'll just heal everything. Now, according to Van Voorhis, there's a few ways to accomplish the goal. To eliminate fossil fuels and buy renewable energy to reduce emissions going forward, and to buy carbon offsets or invest in carbon removal to repair and recalibrate the atmosphere.
Yep. It says nature's technology, in quotes, is the only scalable option to affect and sequester large chunks of carbon affordably, he says.
Ooh, it's so exciting. Now, 30% of all capital invested on Wall Street is now socially and environmentally screened. That's according to accounting for trillions of dollars. Then before he said that shareholders are driving the trend, and 2/3 of all shareholders' resolutions on the environment. Wow. They're being consciously aware. They are, Al. It's an amazing thing to see.
Yeah, it is. Let's see here. They say that agriculture will play a significant role in carbon sequestration. Nice words. Come on, people. But the three main voluntary carbon registries, the American Carbon Registry, Climate Action Reserve, and VERA, are still working to develop methodologies for agriculture carbon credits.
Right. Yes. They go on to say agriculture has had some challenge that forestry doesn't have. So it's just the ease of reversing carbon if practices like tilling are used. They consciously want to make a difference. They're saying that, you know, the carbon is a big ticket, and hemp's going to recalibrate that. I love that. It sounds so poetic, but it's true.
It is true. And the fact that, you know, it can help so much. You know, it cleans the ground. It's over in Chernobyl, cleaning radiation out of the ground. It's cleaning the crap out of the air.
Certainly.
So I guess they in the end that producers can get involved in all this because cannabis is an agricultural crop.
Absolutely, it is. Absolutely, so it is. Yep.
They can get involved in this.
That's right. The article goes on to talk a lot about carbon, but it's something that we should be aware of and something that we should be discussing. Our world is getting hotter by the minute.
Yes.
And hemp can save our planet.
All you had to do was look at the last couple of days.
Yeah.
I don't know what your front lawn is, but I'm seeing a lot of front lawns that look like it's August around here.
Wow.
Yeah. Dried out lawns. You got it. She's heating up. She's hot.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Now, the next story. This is something that we've been following for quite some time. And this is the story of Billy Caldwell, and the headline from Forbes says, courageous boy and mom walking across the UK to support medical cannabis access.
Wow. Wow. Beautiful.
Yes.
Sad that it has to happen, but beautiful that it is happening. Now, a young boy and his single mom are in the midst of a 1,000-mile walk across the United Kingdom. A journey that they are making to raise awareness and funds to provide medical cannabis to chronically ill patients. After leaving their home in Northern Ireland, Charlotte Caldwell and 15-year-old Billy, who suffers from refractory epilepsy and autism, have crossed by ferry to Great Britain on an expedition scheduled to end at the House of Parliament in Westminster on June 14th.
And there's Billy and his mom right there. The Caldwells have had three primary goals in mind as their journey across the UK. The first is to raise awareness and funds for the nonprofit I Am Billy Foundation to provide financial assistance to patients who need support accessing medical cannabis. The walk is also serving as a call to action for the UK government to support evidence-based studies on the efficacy and the safety of cannabis therapies, as well as a public invitation to Matt Hancock, the UK's Secretary of State of Health and Social Care, to meet for a roundtable discussion on the issue.
Wow. Wow. I love that her name is Charlotte because of our dear Charlotte in the United States, for Charlotte's Angel, the little one that passed on. Charlotte, I love that. It's so beautiful that it's all coming together like that. Now, Billy and Charlotte made international headlines in 2018. When her struggle to obtain a cannabis-based medicine for her son, who was enduring up to 400 seizures a day at that time, led to the legalization of medical cannabis in the UK. They haven't been forgotten since then, it seems. Only 7 days into their adventure, the pair have already exceeded their initial goal of raising £5,000 for the foundation, prompting them to set their sights on £15,000.
Nice. It's good to see the support. There's no doubt about that. And I think there was actually a connection to Canada at one time. I believe his mother was getting oil sent to him from here.
Oh, how wonderful.
Yeah. It's amazing. Charlotte Caldwell tells them in a virtual interview, adding that they are humbled by the support that the British nation is showing us. It's money that's sorely needed. Despite the legalization of medical cannabis in the UK, therapeutics derived from the plant are still not routinely covered by the National Health Service. Instead, patients are required to obtain private prescriptions to access their medicine at a cost of up to £2,000 per month or more. In an op-ed published by the political magazine The House, Conservative Party MP Alberto Costa noted that so far the 2018 legalization of medical cannabis in the UK has benefited an appalling low number of NHS patients.
Oh dear. Wow.
Wow.
Something needs to happen. So they're walking across there to make awareness, to bring awareness to this.
Exactly. They sure are.
That's incredible.
I just moved the screen there. And they say that nearly 3 years on, what should have been a watershed moment has resulted in very little change for these affected families. It is to be deeply regretted that by all accounts, only 3 NHS prescriptions have been issued across the country for the type of medical cannabis that is life-threatening for the children affected.
Three.
That's according to the Conservative Party MP. Yeah, just 3.
That's so sad.
That is ridiculous.
Oh,
going on 3 years now. Yep. 2018. Three people, one a year.
I don't even know what to say to that. That's just Billy and Charlotte, thank you and blessings to you for doing this, for making a difference.
The lack of action is having a devastating effect on the chronically ill patients in the UK. Just last week, Rachel Rakemore of Cardiff, Wales, revealed that she could no longer afford the £2,000 a month for cannabis oil for her 19-year-old son, Bailey, who has a rare form of epilepsy known as Lennox-Gastaut syndrome. And the Rakemores have tried dozens of traditional pharmaceutical treatments, but they were either ineffective or caused unacceptable side effects. Cannabis is the only effective medicine, but now Bailey must go without and has no quality of life. She is beaching the NHS to cover the cost.
The NHS that has only covered 3 patients' medicine. 3.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
God. I just can't even. That's awful. So as Rachel says, it's hell living with epilepsy like this, and very cruel to hold funding back for this treatment. We can see it works. We know it works.
That's right.
Yeah.
Wow. That's right. Without the oil, Bailey has really gone downhill. It's heartbreaking. Bailey isn't playing anymore. He's just sitting, not eating, or engaging for more than an hour a day. He went to school on Wednesday, but just slept there all day.
Yep.
Just slept all day.
Because they can't afford it, and the NHS is not affording it.
Can they not see this?
How can they not? Well, Billy and Charlotte are walking across 1,000 miles, walking across the United Kingdom.
Yeah.
Just making the news.
15-year-old boy.
Yep.
Who's epileptic.
Yep. Yep. The picture of them here. Beautiful picture of them here.
And he's having to do this.
Yep.
Well, you can see there's a picture there of him in the hospital as well.
It's right there. I am Billy Foundation. So if anyone's listening and they want to find out more, I think it's definitely a worthwhile cause to look into.
Yes, exactly. I agree. All righty. Good to see an update from what's going on over there with Billy Caldwell. We'll keep an eye on that story for sure. There's no doubt about that. All right. And the last story of the day, the greatest cannabis bust of all time, they say, according to the Growth Op, is the Guyanese police find cannabis in the goat dam.
The goat dam. Oh, my goodness. It's a 4-day stakeout, and it ended when officers in Guyana's customs anti-narcotic unit were able to seize 80 kilograms of cannabis estimated to be worth 10 million Guyana dollars. That's about 58,000.
Yeah, so that's what, yeah. Geez, that's less than $1,000 per kilogram.
I don't think it's the greatest bust of all time, but maybe to them it is.
Yep. During surveillance this week in the Goat Dam area, Live Path Cortine, officers were keeping an eye out for traffickers suspecting of transporting several bags of narcotics. So Goat Dam is a town. It's not a goat, it's not a dam in the river for the goats to get a drink.
Yeah, but look at those big, they look like marshmallows. Look at that. Look at those. Yeah. In the pictures, officers found 10 bulky parcels wrapped in transparent plastic. They're giant.
Looks like cash.
Yeah, something like that. Interesting. So they said that there was surveillance. They kept an eye out. And then their line path is divided by boundaries and on the foreshore. And there's swamps in a coastal plain. I guess they're different swamps dividing the croplands.
Yeah. After about 2 hours of monitoring, the officers noticed three people emerging from the nearby cane field, walking towards them, identifying themselves and shouting at the suspects to stand still. Three opted to flee into the field.
Now, the officers did not pursue the individuals due to the canal separating the dam from the cane field. And then there's the next picture is all the bags thrown in the leaves in the trees.
Yeah. Look at it all. Instead, they began searching the area and soon noticed 10 bulky parcels wrapped in transparent plastic. On closer examination, it appeared the packages contained weed. Drugs were seized and taken for processing.
Well, I bet they were. Police believe the parcels were transported to Suriname and they were going to be for resale.
I would say so. Yeah. And in May, they say that the Guam Times reported a plane crash landed near the town, near the river, with 450 kilograms of cocaine.
So this must be a place.
Yeah. As for cannabis, a routine stop and search exercise at a police checkpoint in Guana revealed a cooler containing 11 frozen chickens stuffed with weed.
They're doing whatever they need to do to get it out there, to transport it. Bags.
This is my herbs. This is my herbs stuffing for my chickens.
I'm making stew.
I'm making stew. Hey, I know. I was at a barbecue years ago, and my friend who was hosting that, she went over to Herb Garden. And it was herbs. It wasn't cannabis. And she shoved them right inside my chicken.
Wow.
Yeah. Too bad it wasn't cannabis, though. But yeah. So there you go. All 10 stories. We are done.
Woohoo.
Yes. So what's going on with the lounge this week?
We are just working hard to get reopened again. Hopefully this month we can do that.
Yes, hopefully. I know there was some talk of maybe a couple of days earlier than the expected June 14th. So I'm hoping that maybe this Friday there would be some type of announcement. And maybe you can open up for the weekend, Kelly.
That would be very nice.
Yeah, it sure would. I'm sure everybody would enjoy that. All righty. Let's see. So nothing to report on, just virtual world.
Just virtual world for now. Everybody stay safe. Sending blessings. Thanks, Al.
All right. Well, that's our Reefer Report for June the 7th, 2021, from the Legacy420.com news desk. And from our buds at BMA Hydroponics, Campbellford Lifestyle Shop, DrBuckCTS.com, and the Campbellford Lifestyle Shop. In closing, we'd like to say thank you for watching and listening. If you enjoyed it, please share with whom you think will benefit from it, a friend, a family member, or the guy just down the street. Plus, don't forget to educate, medicate, and do not incarcerate.
The opinions of the individuals during this broadcast are their own and may not be the opinions of their group or other organizations they may be involved with.
You're listening to the Pace Radio Network here at paceradio.net.
At Legacy 420, we believe in being different.
Experience the difference of quality control.
Our labs provide tested formulations for all of our products.
Experience the difference in trust.
Our customers can trust that we are following up-to-date COVID precautions for their safety.
Experience the difference in accessibility.
We're open 7 days a week. Please visit our website, legacy420.com, or contact us for curbside pickup as well as nationwide mail order shipping.
Legacy 420 values overall wellness.
Come and experience the difference of Legacy 420.
Enjoy the buzz of legalization with Campbellford Lifestyle Shop. From lights to plant nutrients, books, consumption accessories, and more, we've got all your basics to grow or consume cannabis. Visit our info center or take a look at our piercing services and body jewelry, now available in-store through Campbellford Lifestyle Shop, 17 Bridge Street West, Campbellford.
What do you find at paceradio.net? People advocating cannabis education.
CTCP operates a medicinal cannabis signing clinic. If you want to grow your own medicinal cannabis and are located anywhere in Canada, then I'd like to suggest that you give them a call. They can be reached at 1-613-967-9888. That's 1-613-967-9888. And grow on with CTCP.
Growing your own vegetables, flowers, or even medicinal plants can be a challenge without the right equipment and proper know-how. At BMA Hydroponics, not only are they your urban horticultural experts and suppliers, but their staff holds the customer's needs paramount to making a sale. Family-owned with decades of experience and knowledge, they offer free advice in person by phone or email. BMA Hydroponics wants to ensure you have the advice you need, which is why you'll find tips and tricks on different ways to grow, like wick, ebb and flow, drip, or aeroponic system, as well as other helpful links at bmahydroponics.com. If you can't find what you're looking for, just let them know, and they'll do everything they can to get what you're looking for. At BMA Hydroponics, each staff member also possesses a federal exemptee MMAR license, making their strong suit empathy, experience, and dedication to their customers. Because when you know how to grow, you'll have results that make you proud. BMA Hydroponics in Belleville, Ontario. Visit bmahydroponics.com.
A doctor's job is to relieve your pains. And when it comes to growing cannabis, the biggest pain is trimming. Let Dr. Buck Cannabis Trimming Solutions take the pain away. Whether you're a home grower or a commercial operation, we have the cure. From 4 plants to 400 plants, garden size doesn't matter. Dr. Buck Cannabis Trimming Solutions comes to you with years of experience and professional discreet service. It's simple. We trim your weed and we do a damn good job. Visit drbuckcts.com to book your trimming.
Do you want to hear what patients and cannabis advocates have to say? If so, then catch the Pace Radio Show Wednesday nights here on paceradio.net.
We are people advocating cannabis education here at paceradio.net.